In this video, I'm diving into the strange and sometimes confusing world of YouTube copyrights and content ID. So let's go. If you've ever shared your own music on YouTube, or heaven forbid, someone else's music in your videos, you've probably come across the wonderful world of copyright and content ID, and it can be a confusing, slippery slope of copyright claims, copyright strikes, content ID matches. So in this video, I want to break it all down and make it simple so that you know what you can and can't do when it comes to music on YouTube. Let's start with some very general advice. If you want to stay 100% out of copyright trouble on YouTube, don't use anyone else's videos or music as part of your videos. It really is as simple as that. If you use 100% original content of your own creation, you will be 100% fine. Now, there are some unscrupulous folks who may claim that your original material is theirs, and we're going to talk about that at the end of this video. So if you want to learn a little bit more and get some tips about protecting yourself, even if you're sharing your original content, then hang around to the end of this video. Copyright claims in YouTube come in two delicious flavors. One of them is automatic, which is called content ID matching, which we'll talk about in detail in just a moment. And the second is manual copyright claims, where a rights holder will actually claim manually. They'll actually put in a claim on your video saying that they own the rights to some of the audio or the video that's part of your video. So let's jump in and start by talking content ID. So content ID is actually a very clever algorithm used by YouTube, which scans all videos that are uploaded to the platform, and if it finds video or audio that matches copyrighted content, it will actually flag that and it will put in a claim on behalf of the original copyright owner. Now, if you come across one of these, what will happen is you'll get an email from YouTube. It'll look just like this one, and it will tell you that there's either some video or some audio that has actually been matched. You can then jump in and take a look at who is actually claiming it, what the original song or video that's been claiming, who the claimant was, which group or individual or artist is actually claiming that, and then you can also file a dispute. And we'll talk more detail about how to do all of those things and give you some real case studies of my own experience in this video. So let's talk about the consequences of copyright claims. Now, there are three things that can actually be done by copyright owners. Number one is that they can actually take your revenue. So if you've got a monetized video that uses copyrighted material, the copyright owner can actually claim, and then any revenue you earn from advertisers is going to go to that copyright holder instead of to you. Number two is that they can block the content, and this may be in certain different countries. It depends on where the copyright is relevant, but it means that your video will not be able to be viewed. You've probably seen those on YouTube where you click a video and it says, this video is not available in your country. That's the reason why. Number three, if you're super lucky, they will choose to not do anything. So someone like me who doesn't enable content ID on a lot of my music or a lot of my videos that I actually put out there, if you use my videos or if you use my audio, not much is going to happen unless I've enabled content ID, which is something, again, that we'll talk about when I show you a couple of case studies in just a few moments. So copyright claims, not a huge problem. They don't really impact the standing of your channel. It just means if you're monetizing videos, you may lose some of that revenue or you may find your video gets blocked. The evil cousin, however, of the copyright claim is the copyright strike. So this is something where you've used some material. So say you re-upload the entire music video of a popular artist, including all the audio and the video completely unchanged. What the actual music group may choose to do is issue a take down notice. So that means it's going to be removed from YouTube. And what's going to happen to you? You're going to get a copyright strike. So this is why you need to be really careful that you're not using or reusing content that you don't have the rights, the copyright to actually use. Now, with a copyright strike, it can affect your ability to do certain things on your channels, upload videos of certain length, do live streaming. And like most things in life, three strikes and you're out. Your channel will be deleted, removed. So yeah, that's pretty extreme. It is, however, quite difficult. Your copyright claims are gonna happen quite frequently. Copyright strikes, I've never had one, and they're kind of difficult to get, and cross my fingers, touch wood, that hasn't happened to me yet. But if you've had issues or if you've had experience with copyright strikes, let us know your experience down in the comments. We'd love to hear what happened, and hopefully it all worked out okay for you, because the good thing about copyright strikes is after 6 months, they are actually removed again. So if you do make a mistake and you do get a copyright strike, don't worry too much about it. Just make sure that you change your practices. Don't do it again. And after 6 months, you'll be good to go. Let's talk about the second way that you can get a copyright claim on your video. And this is a manual claim. Now, these have come under pretty close scrutiny in recent times because what's happening is that there are a lot of groups out there that are actually abusing the ability to put manual claims on other people's music and other people's videos on YouTube. Now, YouTube have recently cracked down on this and they've started actually changing some of their policies. And I'll link to an article down in the description that you can check out if you want to learn more about that. But the basics of a manual claim are that there is music or there is video or there is some copyrighted content in your video, but content ID matching hasn't picked it up. So you haven't got an automatic content claim from the content ID system. But however, what the copyright owners can do is that they can scroll through, they can go through videos, and if they find that their music, their video, their copyrighted material is being used, they can create a manual claim. Now, in the way these are supposed to work is that yes, you're using a copyrighted song in your video, you shouldn't be doing it, they find it out, and then they put in the copyright claim, and you go through the same process as a content ID claim. And again, I'll give you a case study in just a moment about this. However, what is starting to happen is that people are using like 2 seconds of audio incidentally because it's playing in the background, and then these copyright claimants are coming in and saying, no, you can't do that, we're taking all your revenue. Again, YouTube have put in some changes that are going to help with that, and you can check out those changes down below. In its worst form, what is happening is that now there are groups that are going around and finding any opportunity where they can actually claim. And again, it can be something very small, or it can actually not have any relevance at all. So oftentimes, we're hearing from other content creators, I haven't had this happen yet, but others, where their video has no copyrighted material, they'll get a copyright claim based on a song that has nothing to do with anything that is in their video. So they may release their own original song, and then they get a copyright claim saying, hey, this is a song by insert artist here, and it's 100% not. So the problem here and what's happened is that anytime someone can make some revenue and take other people's revenue, they're going to try to do it. And if you get this copyright claim and do nothing about it, then that's exactly what's going to happen. Any revenue you make from that is going to go to them, or they may be able to get your videos blocked if they don't want it to actually be shown. However, there is a way to dispute these claims, and that's what we're going to jump into now. I'm going to take you through a couple of case studies of things that have happened to me just to show you the process you can go through here if you get a copyright claim. So for the first case study here, let's take a look at a video example. So here is an email I received from YouTube. I created a music video and I happened to use some clips from the movie A League of Their Own, one of my personal favorite movies. It was just for a bit of fun. It was on a different channel. I had no intention of monetizing this video. However, it was picked up by Sony and they said, Sony Pictures said, yes, we would really prefer that we actually claim any monetization if this video is monetized. So here's the email that I got. Now, when we actually jump in and take a look at YouTube, this is what it looks like. So you can see here, channel impact is not affected. So this content ID claim on your video will not affect my channel. So that's a good thing. The visibility is still public. Now, if it happened to be that it was blocked, that's where it would actually say it's blocked in the following countries. And then you can see where your video has been blocked. And then monetization is ineligible. So even though you're not in the YouTube partner program, ads may be showing. So because this is on a channel where I'm not monetizing anyway, it's going to be crossed through there. What you may find is that sometimes there'll be revenue sharing. So depending how the copyright is set up, that may turn into a little yellow dollar sign or a different sort of dollar sign there. So if it's green, it means everything's all good. If it's anything else, then there'll either be revenue sharing or all of the revenue from that video will be going over to another party, which we'll show you in another case study here as well. So that is what it looks like from a video perspective. And we'll show you, if we wanted to dispute this, how we would actually do that in the next case study, which is this one. And this is an interesting one because this is where I actually have a claim against myself. So I released a song called Goats using the Amuse platform, which actually enables you to add content ID to your release. So it's a very cool feature. It's 100% free and it adds content ID to your song. However, at the same time, I was creating videos like this one about the creation process of the song. And what happened is when I finally released that song, the content ID system worked perfectly in that it picked up all of the uses on my channel of my song Goats and it claimed them. those back to Amuse. So I guess in this case, I still get the revenue, but via Amuse instead of via YouTube for these videos. So it hasn't impacted me, but if it was another artist, so let's say you are the artist, you release through Amuse, and then someone actually uses your song, this shows you that the Content ID system will find that song, it will match it, and then it will send any revenue that video makes back to you, which is, after all, a good thing. And here's what it looks like again in YouTube. So you can see here, there's no viewing restrictions. The monetization is it's monetized by the claimant there. Again, similar to the other video there, but because this is monetized, any revenue will go to the claimant, which again is Amuse on behalf of Studio Live Today Records, which is me. So it's monetized by the copyright owner. Now there's a couple of things that we can do here to look at this. We can play the match, as you can see down there. We can actually remove the song. So what that will do is you can actually edit out the section where you're using that music, resubmit to YouTube, and then the copyright claim can be removed. So you can actually do that. You can remove that chunk from your video if it was, say, a 5 second or 10 second chunk that wasn't crucial to the video, you can do it that way. The other thing you can do is to file a dispute if the claim was not something that was actually correct, if it was not the song that they're claiming it to be. So let's show you those steps you go through if you click the file a dispute button. So when you click the button, the first thing you're asked is, what is the reason why you're actually claiming? Why are you disputing this? What evidence do you have, or what reason do you have behind it? So once you select one of those options, we move on to the next section where you are now asked to 100% confirm. So you basically have a statement there. You have to say, yes, that's exactly what happened, before you can continue on to the final stage, which is your final declaration. And that looks like this. You get to explain exactly why you're actually claiming that this is your original work and that you are not breaching copyright. You then have to enter your name as an electronic signature there, and then you can submit your dispute. Now, the dispute gets reviewed. The claimant actually has 30 days to respond. So here's the good news. If they don't respond within 30 days, then the claim disappears from your video. So that's a really good thing, because these companies or these groups that are going around putting out 1,000 manual claims every day on a bunch of different videos just to see which ones stick, they are not going to have the time to go back and completely put all the details in to their claim if people are actually disputing them. So they're just hoping that enough people will just ignore it or not realize it's happened, that they're going to get a little chunk of revenue. It's kind of like spammers. It doesn't matter if 0.1% of people don't do it, then if they do enough, if you do enough volume, you're still going to make some of your revenue. So if you are working hard and you're a hard-earned creator and you're trying to monetize your content, then make sure that you keep an eye on your email inbox. If you get a claim like this that you think is not founded, then raise a dispute. Like I say, it's only 30 days, and then if nothing responds, then it goes back. If they do respond and it's deemed that you have breached copyright based on the evidence on the video, then yes, the claim will stay. But if you are wanting to, if you really think that you're not actually in breach, file a dispute and see what happens. Now, I realize that in this video, we've been talking about this from the perspective of you as a video creator or a music creator on YouTube. We're not really looking at you as the original copyright owner. However, there are a couple of things that you can do when you're releasing your music. And the easiest one to do is to use Content ID. So Amuse, who are a free distribution platform, I've got videos about them down there and up the top there at the moment that you can check out. They actually allow you to release to YouTube and turn on Content ID for free, which is a pretty cool service. You can see it kind of sort of backfired for me in this case, but if you did want to make sure you're protecting your music, you can do it that way. Other platforms like DistroKid actually have that as an additional feature. So you do have to pay a premium to get Content ID on your music releases. So that is one way that you can actually protect yourself as the music creator by enabling Content ID on YouTube. So let's circle right back around and summarize with this. The way to stay 100% safe here on YouTube, if you are releasing videos or releasing music, is to use 100% your own original work. As we mentioned, people may still try to claim against you, but now you know how you can go about filing a dispute to make sure that that doesn't go through. The other thing I want to recommend is the YouTube audio library. If you aren't creating your own music and you want some background music for your videos, check out the YouTube audio library, completely royalty free. That'll be linked down in the description as well. And of course, you can create your own music in GarageBand. And I've got hundreds of videos right here on the channel to help you do just that. Thanks again for watching. There's two more videos all about YouTube and creating videos and sharing on YouTube down below. You can subscribe to the channel by clicking and tapping on the Studio Live Today icon, and I'll see you on the next video.